1
Okay. Everybody could please be seated. Just before everything else begins, there are a lot of people who put in effort to make tonight happen. First and foremost, all the Talmidim, everybody who's here who made it possible for the purchase of the Sefer Torah to be able to give it, yisher koach, and the fact that everybody participated and everybody was running after us, everybody wanted to be part of it. But on a more practical level, there are a million little things that had to get done, and people did them. Special thank you, Mayor Perry, but Barnea with the Safe, and Moshe Foreman, and there are a few people who put in a lot of effort. So first, I did. So first and foremost, all of the details of the Sefer Torah and the sofer and the coverings, and I can't even tell you the million and one details. I usually heard one side of the phone call, but Rav Shaftol, who wouldn't have happened without him. Next, everybody, I think everybody already knows, but if Moshe Wolshinsky would not have found time in that 25th and 26th hour of the day to be able to make this happen, this mamish, literally impossible to have happened for Moshe, big yisher koach. And certainly not lastly, but we sit here in a beautiful dining room with an unbelievably I saw it. I figured it was always like this. People have told me it's usually a rather depressing place. But the Rav Moshe Leo and Esti and Chagit, without Esti's love and care, she was dealing with a bunch of men. So men, you know, we do things quickly. But without Esti putting her foot through, without putting full power to it, we would be eating out of, you know, some canned food on a porch somewhere. So, you know. Welcome, everybody. People came from around the world. It was really very special. It's been very nice, even for those of us who are here. I live very, very far away in Har Nof. I see Rebbe once a year, maybe, when he comes to Har Nof, right? But for us to get together, even tonight, as friends, as colleagues, as Talmidim, as people that care about the same things, that people that care about our Rebbe and his Rebbetzin, and people that care about each other, it's a very special thing to happen. About 4 years ago, a number of us were talking by telephone and email, because we unfortunately never see each other, but a number of us were talking that we wanted to get something to show Hakaras HaTov for Rebbe for an unmentioned occasion, which I can't mention anymore, and we were off by 3 years for this unmentioned occasion, so we had a little more time. Then, when we decided to start doing it, out of our terror of telling Rebbe in advance, we started writing the Sefer Torah, and we told him about it 4 months into it. So even if he wouldn't have liked the idea, he couldn't back out at that point. But Baruch Hashem, I think it's been a beautiful, beautiful evening. There are Talmidim here from, you know, the people who have come up and introduced themselves to me tonight it's been amazing. Mayor Perry, myself, and Moshe had one unbelievable insight because we had access to the Sefer Torah gift Gmail account and to the responses on the invitations. And to see what people wrote, to see Pashut what was written, this isn't a question of, you know, we're talking to a bunch of people who know Rebbe. I don't need to talk about Rebbe, but that the things people say, it's not just, oh, the Torah is brilliant, big deal. It's that people talk about how their lives were affected, their lives were changed, the impact it made on them, the way they see the world. And the notes are absolutely beautiful. And yeah, we'll, Birtz Hashem, we'll get them to Rebbe too, so you can see them. People from all over the world. Somebody commented to me tonight, it's unbelievable. It's not so unbelievable if you but on a real level, but it's unbelievable in the way people view Olam Hazeh, that we should have so many hundreds of people who are participating. Some are participating online. Some of those who are here tonight, there's no institution. There's no institution. We like to think of things can only happen in institutions. There's no institution here. The Torah itself is meaningful enough and valuable enough, and Rebbe has been meaningful enough and valuable enough for this to happen. You know, I walked into Kerem Yeshiva 40 years ago. 40 years ago, about 2 weeks from now. And I never would have thought 40 years ago the level of impact that would have on my life and Baruch Hashem and the life of my family who are here and the life of my Talmidim and the life of my friends, you know, who are, it's unbelievable. There are people in this room who have been friends, have been in yeshiva together for over 40 years. So on behalf of the Talmidim, I asked one of the oldest Talmidim, meaning longest Talmidim, not necessarily the oldest, but the longest Talmidim, Rav Moshe Leo, that he should share a few words with us.
Moray v'rabotai, ladies and gentlemen, and of course, Rebbe and Rebbetzin. When I speak at an event, I usually speak in behalf of my wife and myself. And this is enough difficult to speak in behalf of Esti. Here tonight, I am speaking actually in behalf of Rebbe's Talmidim. Wow. We are talking about hundreds of Talmidim throughout the past 40 and some years or so who have learned directly in person from Rebbe in Toronto, Baltimore, San Jose, various places in Eretz Yisrael, as well as the many of us who are joining in the Shirim electronically from all over the world. So many of us whose lives have been so deeply affected by Rebbe. I will try to say a few words that are expressing the feelings and the thoughts of all of us who are present here tonight, as well as the ones who could not make it. I will try to say it actually in just two words. The Gemara in Avodah Zarah tells us about a human condition called Kfuye Tova. Bnei Yisrael are called Kfuye Tova, B'nei Kefuye Tova. Rebbe has translated this to mean that we humans are not always willing to acknowledge gratitude because it is too painful to feel indebted to others, even to the Ribono Shel Olam himself. The Gemara there says that it actually took 40 years for that message to come through. 40 years to finally accept, acknowledge, and be grateful. So, after 40 years of Rebbe continuously teaching us Torah, knowledge, understanding, we, the Talmidim and their family, are finally acknowledging and are proud to say these two words. Thank you. Thank you, Rebbe, for leading us not only into Chaya Olam Haba, but for being there with us in this crazy world, showing us the path of life, caring for all of us with so much love and concern. On a more personal tone, well, it's over 40 years since I first met Rebbe in Eretz Yisrael. Instantly, I fell in love with Rebbe, Rebbetzin, and the family. After some hesitation, I joined Rebbe's Bekiyas Chabura and its wonderful and devoted members, such as scary-looking Moshe, wisecracker Avi, the black belt Yankee, Gabi, the Israeli-Mexican, and a few crazy others who have decided to follow Rebbe into this exciting new adventure. More special Talmidim, such as Chaim, the New Yorker, who really wasn't, and others joined in keeping up the pace of three blat a day, learning, and chazering on and on. This chabura is where it all started. When Rebbe stood up and decided to make a shift, press the reset button, refusing to be part of a system that was going nowhere, Torah had to be real, wholesome, and also fun. A lot of fun. Strolling down memory lane, fall 1976, San Jose, California, here we come. The dream of having a place of our own is crystallizing. Kerem. What a wonderful place. With incredible Mesiras Nefesh, Rebbe, Rebbetzin, along with Rav Shalom, Rabbi Lapping, are planning this vineyard with so much loving care and devotion. At this point, Rebbe is a Rosh Yeshiva in charge of a rapidly growing institution. The Rebbe, who is involved with the lives of every one of us, the visionary, thinker, philosopher, developing concepts and ideas, revolutionizing Jewish thought all at once. There, the beautiful family is growing and flourishing thanks to the incredible Mesiras Nefesh of Rebbetzin, which I would like to add, so the Talmidim grew so much because of Rebbetzin. However, this idyllic place did not withstand the petty and mean-spirited snake, and sadly, Kerem has become a legend. Fortunately, Rebbetzin and the family have made Aliyah, and the new community of Talmidim has emerged right here in Yerushalayim. Talmidim, who have to remind themselves constantly how fortunate they are. Indeed, we are so fortunate to live here in Yerushalayim, Ir HaKodesh, and be so close to Rebbe, learn from Rebbe, and be part of his vision. We would like to wish Rebbe and Rebbetzin a long and healthy life, full of naches, smachot, many, many years of learning, teaching, tending the vineyard, and brightening the Neri soil, enlightening us, the entire world. Ad bias ha-goel b'merov yomeinu, amen.
All the Talmidim, I think it's true now too. I can't even speak for it because I'm unfortunately not around enough, but I'm sure it's true. While we were getting from Rebbe, we were also stealing from his family. Worked on two levels. On the one hand, we became very much a part of that family. And Mitzad Sheni, we certainly took his time from that family. I have been Zoche in the 18 years that I've had my own yeshiva, working very closely with my very close friend who I've known since he was a little boy, Rav Shaftel, and I asked him if he could say a few words on behalf of the family tonight.
So I do represent the family. Brothers, sisters, brothers-in-law, sisters-in-law, nieces, nephews. And although Rabbi Katz says that it's because he asked me to, based on our long relationship, we could be honest, and the real reason is because I'm just the oldest. Now, it's true that I am here to represent the family, but you see, there's something very strange about getting up to represent the family when there is such a fusion that has happened over the years between family and the Talmidim. I'm not sure where exactly the delineating line is. Is Ramesh Eliyahu family, or is he a Talmid? Is Esti, she's not my sister? Okay. Ramesha Miller and Grizzy aren't family? How about Moshe Olshinsky and his wife? So the line between family and Talmud has become, to me, so fuzzy that I think it would be more accurate to say that I'm just here to speak. I want to make a small he'ora, being as I am a son, a small he'ora regarding a tzivui that appears in the Torah in two places, and yet the Bairei expresses it very differently in the two places. The first place is in Parshas Ve'eschanan, where the Bairei is Mitzaveos Veshinantam Levonecha V'dibartabam. The second place is in Parshas Ekev, where the Bairei is Mitzaveos V'limadetam Eisam Es B'neichem L'dabirbam. And if you'll notice, there is a very big difference between the forms in which the Bairei expresses himself. In the former, he is giving a tzivui to the parent, Vishinantam Levonecha, and then he's turning back to the parent and saying to him, Vedibarta Bam, talking again to the parent. While as in the second place, the Bairei is saying, Vilimadeta Maysam es Bneichem, Ledaber bum, that your children should be the ones who are medaber bum. And this difference requires clarification. Why indeed would the Bairei express himself in what seems to be almost the same tzivui so very differently? Vishinantam Levonecha is talking to the parent regarding an obligation that he has towards his child. The Dibarta Bam is talking back to that same parent, and it is commissioning him with a directive. The Dibarta Bam. While as later it is Vilimadeta Maysam es Bneichem Ledabir Bam. Why? Why would the Bairei express himself so very differently in that which seems on the surface to be the same tzivui? And the answer is based on the wording that the Bairei uses. In the former, he says, Vishinantam Levonecha. And in the latter, he says, Velimadetam Eisam. Vishinantam Levonecha, as Rashi brings down over there, means, Sheyiyu Divrei Torah Mishunonim Beficha. That if someone should ask you regarding what it is that you're learning, there should be no stuttering and searching for the information. Rather, it is at the tip of your fingers. Vilimadetem is to teach. In order for a child to ever be able to appreciate Torah to that degree, that he is going to actually put in the work to achieve a degree of vishinantam, he requires that the parent act to him as a representative of what Torah is. And so Memela, the Pasuk says, you want to be vishinantam levonecha? You want to see that fulfilled? Well, then you better be v'dibartabam. You, parent, must be v'dibartabam. You want to teach somebody something, it doesn't really make a difference. But if you want somebody to become a walking Torah so that it is Vishinantam, that the Divrei Torah are Mishunonim Beficha, the only way that such a thing could be accomplished is if you are to him a symbol of everything that Torah could be, would be, and should be. And so Memela, when the Bairei is mitzave, the parent Vishinantam Levonecha, that the Divrei Torah have to be Mishunanim, the Bairei is telling the parent, you want to know how that could possibly come to be? If Vidibarta Bam, if you are Medaber Bam. While as when it comes to mere teaching, Vilimadata Maysam es Bneichem Medaber Bam, anybody can do that. More than anything, for both family and Talmidim, we talk about the greatness of Torah, the broadness of Torah, the infinity of Torah. That concept that we appreciate as children and as Talmidim comes through what Abba has managed to present to us. All of us here, not only that which we know, but that which we envision, that's what we dream, everything that we aspire to, the idea of that Divrei Torah are so incredible that no matter where you're asked, you already have something to think about. A full degree of Vishinantam comes through the fact that Abba is V'dibartabam all the time. A walking, talking, never stopping thinking, V'dibartabam. Any parent, almost any parent, could theoretically fulfill the obligation of Ilimadeta Maysam as B'neichem. But only unique parents can fulfill the obligation of Vishinantam Levonecha, which comes through Evi Dibartabam. And that Abba has done for his Banim, Tarti Mashma, all of his family, and also for all of his Talmidim. And that, I believe, is the secret to this, that all of the Talmidim and all of the family are able to see things so huge, so big, so vast, so great. It comes through the fact that Abba is a constant V'dibartabam. V'shinantam levonecha V'dibartabam. Everybody is familiar with the famous Medrash that says that before HaKadosh Baruch Hu agreed to give Klal Yisrael the Torah, he asked them who is going to be the guarantor for the transmission of the Torah, and that Klal Yisrael responded that our children will be the guarantor. Our children are arevim that the Torah shall be transmitted. But there is a less well-known Medrash, which appears in the Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer, that says as follows. When Hashem told Moshe Rabbeinu to present the Torah to Bnei Yisrael, so Moshe Rabbeinu was going to go to the men. So Hashem said to him, and these are my words, of course, don't waste your time with the men. Just give it to the women. And if the women will accept the Torah, then the men will automatically follow. Now, I don't want to get into all of that. But the deep truth of that chazal has never been more clear than in our family, where the Torah comes and is transmitted through a combo of Ima and Abba, Ima giving us what we would call the foundation and Abba giving us what we would call the dream. And a team like that, which supplies the child not only with a foundation, but also with a dream of greatness, is an unbelievable partnership. And so again, family, Talmidim, I don't know the difference, and I don't think that there is a difference, have all benefited from this combo, where Ima has been the founding mother, as we call it, while Abba has acted the founding father. Vishinantam levonecha, Chazal say, vonecha elu talmidecha, the dibartabam has been true both for Abba and for Ima. Today we gather to be mekayim a mitzvah. The Rambam counts this as the 18th mitzvah saseh, that the Bayer was mitzvah us to write a Sefer Torah. And interestingly enough, the Rambam gets off on a weird tangent. And he starts talking about Afal Pishe Nichule Avesav Sefer Torah. I don't mean it that way. I'm just talking about the Rambam. Yeah. That afal pishe nichulei avos of Sefer Torah, the idea of writing a new Sefer Torah, etc. For me as a child and as a Talmud, and I think I speak here for all the family and for all the Talmidim, it has been an unbelievable experience to be able to be involved in the kiyum of this mitzvah for Abba, one that makes me very, very emotional. And I want to close by giving a bracha to all of us that Abba and Ima should be zeichet to use this Sefer Torah for many, many, many years to come and to transmit it further, v'shinantam levonecha v'dibartabam v'limadetam eisam es b'neichem b'nei banim hareim kebanim v'day lachkima b'remiza. And that all of us should be zeichet to bring that Sefer Torah up with us to the Beis HaMikdash. Like the Gemara says, that everybody would bring their Sefer Torah and show it off to see what a beautiful Sefer Torah. And there's no question in my mind, just based on that Tzichaim alone, that Abba would win hands down.
Everybody should enjoy each other and the rest of the meal. Rebbe will be speaking after the main courses, sir. Thank you.
Waiting for people to log on. Screens are set up.
Our final speaker clearly does not need any introduction, but in introduction, what I'll say is as follows. If anybody needs to leave, they should feel they can do so. They don't have to stay. If you feel you're going to feel awkward while getting up in the middle, and I'll repeat that. Nobody should feel awkward if they have to leave. We specifically did it after the main. I did not give Rebbe a hagbalah in terms of time, so we may be here till tomorrow. Now, also, Rebbe loves little kids. I know he loves little kids. I just don't think he loves them running around while he's speaking. So, with no further ado, Rebbe.
Siona is here. You said you didn't get the link. Close to the mic. As you know, I'm not used to speaking from such a distance. Usually the Divrei Torah are much more intimate, so this is a bit difficult for me. But I really want to repeat first what Rav Aaron mentioned. Anybody who feels a need to get out of here on time should please, please feel very much free to leave. I always say that before my Fidel Castro-style shiurim. This is well known. So please do not feel that you have to sit, especially when you have children that have to be taken care of. It's perfectly, perfectly appropriate and wonderful to leave when you have to. And for those few diehards that may still be here at midnight and so on, maybe we'll break out another dessert. Is there a little shtender here, maybe? Amud? Where's the gentleman that takes care of it? Yesh kan ulay ez amud, ma she'ani lo yechol lirot mimerchak kazu. Ken, mashu. While he's trying to get some amud, let me just first say that it's impossible for me to express my hakoras teva for those who were nichnasim ba'ovi hakora that did so much to make this happen with so much care, so much love, and so much besiris nefesh. I really and truly appreciate everything that you put in, and to all those who are mishtatev, very much appreciate the amazing hishtatvas from afar. I'll have to wait till this stops also. I can't speak like this. If there's someone that can speak to staff and tell them I just can't go on here. Yesh eze amud? משהו, איזה ספרים או משהו, כי אני פשוט לא יכול לראות ממרחק כזה. Someone's got an idea. Thanks. Okay. Yeah, it's a help. It's not great. It's a help. Yeah. It's better. Thank you so much. So I want to thank everyone on so many different levels. And if you have patience for my slow thinking, I'd like to explore these different levels with you. First of all, for many, many decades, I must tell you that I have worried and worried about this mitzvah. This last of the Tariag mitzvahs that so often gets left out of an individual's life is one difficult mitzvah to be mekayim. There were many false starts during that time, which constraints both of time, learning safras, doing all the work that was necessary. That's good. And finances was a critical factor. And those false starts, I was never able, all came to naught. I was never able to be mekayim this mitzvah. So the sense of gratitude to you, and obviously there ought to be the sense of gratitude to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which is so palpable, there ought to be a way to express it in the words of bracha. Normally, when we have that sense of gratitude, we make a bracha shechiyonu. The problem is that the Mogen Avraham writes that we do not make a shechiyonu on this mitzvah, and on even the finishing the Sefer Torah, because mitzvahs lav lehenes nitnu. The Mishnah Berurah brings that a mitzvah that doesn't come from time to time, and this is a one-time mitzvah, you don't say shechiyonu on. It's a very difficult situation because there's a very deep feeling that you want to make a shechiyonu. It's true that Reb Shlomo Zalman Zatzal separated between the mitzvah and the gift. Normally a person that gets a gift, even a small gift, a new suit, make a bracha on that, shechiyonu. So therefore he says that you should specifically make a shechiyonu on accepting the amazing gift, and not on the bracha shechiyonu on the mitzvah per se. The problem is that many argue on that. They say that even the nature of a gift, which is itself mitzvahs lav lehenes nitu, there's nothing personal that shechiyonu would express, should not be made. The Birchei Yosef comes up with the idea, the classic idea, when you can't make a shechiyonu, you know, you can always put on a new suit, buy a new pri, you know, make a shechiyonu on that. And that way you should have in mind the shechiyonu on the other thing, which leaves something to be desired in terms of the emotional fulfillment of the shechiyonu. In this particular case, I think that even the gift and the people that are involved in the gift, we also have a problem, even according to Reb Shlomo Zalman, that I'll explain later, that they themselves are so much part of the mitzvahs lav lehenes nitnu in a personal fashion that I couldn't even rely on Reb Shlomo Zalman. I'll explain why if you have patience for me. But I do have a wonderful etzah for the Birchei Yosef without needing to buy anything new and without having access to some exotic fruit, and that is the fact that the people that are here tonight are mechayev me to make a shechiyonu just on their presence. And that shechiyonu is a shechiyonu that is certainly part of this ma'amad, is certainly something that does give immense emotional fulfillment. And that, I think, is certainly kelel, some of the aspects of the mitzvah itself, again, as I hope to explore together and to explain. So please answer, Amen, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu, Melech ha'olam, she'achyanu v'kiyamanu v'higiyanu lazman hazeh. Clearly, I mean, that's the fact that there's no Shekhyonu, people view as a logistic problem, sort of a technical snafu that makes it, you know, sometimes halacha doesn't come along properly with the emotions, you know. And that's how they view this. In reality, I think it's an expression of a very deep truth about this entire simcha. And it's kedai for us to understand it. One thing is that I detect here a very minimal amount of the sentimental quality that generally infects these type of occasions. Achmasa Sefer Torah, milestone occasions, and so on. Some mistake the gift of a Sefer Torah as the most glorious set of chumashim that they can give, and they look at the personal humanity of the gift and the moment and personal milestones as being what's important. But the idea that the Magen Avraham is expressing is that mitzvah lav lehenes nitnu means that reducing something of this amazing importance to something that is merely a personal experience of a life event and of a simcha that revolves around oneself is a terrible mistake. And to reduce it to a shechiyanu that is made on a personal level is actually limiting the experience of the simcha and limiting the akaras teva that one has to have for this moment. Because a Sefer Torah is not a glorious set of chumashim. The mitzvah slav lehenes nitnu in this case means that we're talking about something far beyond what we normally deal with. And I would like to explore with you how I feel about this mitzvah of Sefer Torah, what it means to me, and why I believe that your presence here is an innate part of the simcha of the mitzvah of the Sefer Torah per se. Now, we know there's special moments in life, there's special people, special relationships in life, and certainly this moment and these people represent that. Those moments have a certain intimacy, which is referred to in the Torah as machmad, something that in the Luchais, the lo tachmod, not to look at something that is someone else's intimate thing, but is also a way to refer to the thing itself. Machmad, Torah itself, of course, is the kli chemda shebo nivra olam, the hanechemadim. The posuk refers to divrei Torah. Nechemadim mizahav mipazrav. There's something that has that chemda quality, that intimacy, and that kli chemda. Sometimes we don't realize the relationship that that implies. And I want to tell you an amazing story from Tanakh that I think gives a certain insight into what that is. So we know there was a melech by the name of Achav. Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Achav was a melech for 22 years. Achav was a melech, the Gemara says, was one of the only three malachim in history that were melech bekipa. And according to other midrashim, Achav, Shlomo HaMelech was the fourth melech, who was melech misefei lamatsefei, and Achav was the fifth. And these are the only malachim from Klal Yisrael that had that thing. The Torah says, "Rak lo haya ke Achav asher itbaker lasot hara b'nei Hashem." There was never anybody who sold his soul to do that which was evil in the eyes of Hashem, and yet he had an amazingly successful malchus. And the question the Gemara asks is, where was he zeicher to 22 years of such successful malchus, in which historically speaking we find Achav's presence and soldiers of Achav present in the furthest reaches of civilization at that time, way beyond the borders of Eretz Yisrael, shocking geopolitical presence that is confirmed by documents that are found in places where no one would ever expect it. What in the world gave him this chus? So the Gemara asks this kasha. The Gemara gives, Rabbi Yochanan and the Gemara gives it a beautiful answer. 22 years, where did those 22 years come from? So before we see, listen to the Gemara, let me read you from Tanakh the story, because the story is so shocking. There was a fateful moment, a desperate and fateful moment that defined the life of Achav and that defined his malchus. And that was when Ben-Hadad, who was the king of Aram, got together 32 allies to be able to attack Achav. So he and 32 allies from all over the world mounted a massive attack on Shomron, and it was an attack that was absolutely impossible to conceive for Achav to be able to do anything about it. And it was clear that that was the case. And so it says, Vayishlach Malachi Malachav Melach Yisrael Ha'ira. He sends messengers to Achav. And he says, Ko Amar Ben-Hadad, let me tell you my terms. My terms are, Kaspecha Zahavcha Lihu. Everything you own is mine. Nashecha, your wives. Banecha Hatovim, Lihem. Do we have an agreement that your families are mine? Vayan Melech Yisrael, Vayomer Kidvorcha Adonai HaMelech. Can you imagine the horrific situation? Yes, sir, my master, the king. It is true. Lecha ani v'chol asher li. I am yours. Everything that's mine is yours. And so they came back after they reported to Ben-Hadad, and they said, Ko amar Ben-Hadad lemor. Okay, then we have an understanding. Ki shalachti alecha lemor kaspecha uzavcha nashecho v'necha li titein. And we're agreed on that. So tomorrow I am going to send my representatives and take what I like. Ki im ke'et machar, eshlach et avadai alecha, v'chipsu et beitcha v'et batei avadecha. They will go through every home that they want to. Vayakom machamad einecha. Everything that is a chemda in your eyes. Yasimu biadam will be put in their hands and they will walk away with it. It sounds like that's what he had agreed to. Vayikra melech Yisrael kol ziknei ha'aretz. He makes a massive conference of all of the Zakenim, Vayomer de'una ura'u, something is wrong. Ki ra'az ze mevakesh. Ki shalach elai, the guy asked me yesterday, he said he's going to take my wife, he's going to take my kids, he's going to take kaspi v'zavi v'lo manati mimeno, and I said, go right ahead. And now, what more does he want? Why does he say, Ko machamad enecha? What is he adding with machamad enecha? Vayomru elav kol hazekenim v'chol ha'am al tishma v'lo toveh. Forget about it. Do not listen. What do you mean, do not listen? Obviously, the situation is hopeless. Not to listen is suicide. We're not talking about a few, you know, right-wingers here. We're talking about v'chol ha'am. We're talking about all the zekenim. V'chol ha'am, forget about it. And what are we going to do? No idea what we're going to do, but we're not going to do that. And so, famous story of the Vayomer l'malachei Ben-Hadad, I'm sorry, Imru l'Adoni HaMelech, you can tell my master the king, Everything that you said, the first message, I am willing to do. But this, הדבר הזה, לא אוכל לעשות. I simply cannot do this, and that's it. So it's total war. Says Rabbi Yochanan, why was he zochet at 22 years of Malchus? Because what do you think this Machmad Einecha was? What could possibly be Machmad Einav? There's only one thing that could possibly be more valuable than his wives, his children, his money, everything that he felt was valuable. It's got to be the Sefer Torah. So because מפני שכיבד את התורה שניתנה ב-22 אותיות, because there's 22 אותיות in the Torah, therefore HaKadosh Baruch Hu did a nes, gave him the entire victory because he was mechabed the Torah. Everything that had been said before was not machamad. His children were not machamad enough. His wives, his heirlooms, everything that he had was not machamad. But this, says Rashi, this is hanechemadim mizahavu mipazrav, has got to refer to the Sefer Torah. More nechmad than zahav mipazrav. So, it's absolutely astounding. I mean, it's strange because what this means is that the idea, I mean, how many people today would feel that way about a Sefer Torah? This is all of Klal Yisrael, of Chol Ha'am, willing to give up their children and not willing to hand over a Sefer Torah. I mean, how could the Torah take that place in the hearts of people that were mitmachrim to do the ra b'inei Hashem? I mean, it sounds to us, it's shocking. Most people view, as I say, a glorified chumash. Obviously, that's not what we're talking about over here. We're talking about something entirely different. So I would like to examine some of the halachas about the nature of a Sefer Torah. I know that sometimes halachas maybe people feel are boring and don't give us a direct access to understanding things. And I hope, if you're not too intimidated and you could bear with me, that we'll be able to come to some deeper understanding. Because to say that people that were so nichshal in Aveda Zora, people that were willing to give away everything that was intimate to them, would not consider, lo toved, don't even think about it. And one very strange thing is that Reb Yochanan says, the 22 years are connected, the 22 letters of the Sefer Torah. I mean, I would have understood if it would have been 24 years, you know, connected Chof Dalet Sforim, it would have been 5 years, connected Chamisha Chum Sheitera, 22 years, I mean, everything written from a children's primer to a plain chumash has got 22 letters, for God's sake. So what is the big deal that he was b'chabed the Torah, and the Torah is written in 22 letters? Of course it's written in 22 letters. That's how many letters there are in the alphabet. I mean, so why is that the schus? Which means there's no way out of the clear-cut conclusion that the relationship of chemda was built specifically of ksav. It was the ksav, per se, that caused that sense of chemda, and because of that, the schus was indeed in terms of the ICS. In order to understand this, I want to first bring to you a contradiction in the Rambam in the nature of Hilchas Sefer Torah. We know there's two completely different mitzvahs of Ksiva Sefer Torah. One of them is the closing mitzvah of the Torah in Parshas Vayelech, which is Kisvu Lachem Es Hashira Azeis, and that Kisvu Lachem is Ad Tumei and refers to Kol HaTorah Kula. Fine. The other is a mitzvah that occurs much earlier in the Dinim of the Melech. So there we're talking about in Shoftim, the Melech, Vayar, Kishifto, as he becomes a Melech, V'kosav lo, Sefer Torah, yes, to write, we don't even know there's a din of Ksivas, Sefer Torah in general yet, but he has to write a special Sefer Torah. this Mishneh Torah Hazot, which ends up becoming a chiyev to write a Sefer Torah on a melech, the Rambam contradicts himself in a strange way in the two halachas. Listen carefully to how he puts it. So first in Hilchas Sefer Torah, where he speaks about this mitzvah that we're being Isaac in tonight, mitzvah taseh al kol ish v'ish mi Yisrael lichtov Sefer Torah la'atzmo, shenemar ve'ata kitvu lachem et ashira, klomar kitvu lachem Torah shesh bo shira, ve'af al pi shi'inichu lo avotav Sefer Torah, even if a person has inherited a Sefer Torah, mitzvah lichtov mishalo, there's a mitzvah to write his own. Ve'im katavo biyado, if he writes it in his own hand, areu ki'ilu kibla mehar Sinai. It says, if he was there standing on Har Sinai and he received this Torah. Ve'im eino yodea lichtov, acharim kotvim lo. V'chol ha-magia sefer Torah filo ot echat, and if he fixes even one ot, and that makes the sefer Torah kosher, areihu ki'ilu katvo kulo. Very clear. You cannot be yotze with an inherited sefer. You must write your own sefer or have a sefer written for you. The problem is that in Hilchot Melachim, the Rambam brings the following halacha about the melech. Ba'it sheyeshev ha-melech al kisei malchuto, kotev lo sefer Torah la'atzmo, yeter ala sefer shenichu lo avotav. It's exactly the same halacha. So beyond any sefer that was left to him by his forefathers, that would mean even if they themselves were kings, and they had svarim that were written as svarim for a king, he has to write another one. And that one that he has to write, al pi bezdin shel shivim v'echad, he needs a full bezdin agadol in Yerushalayim, to be magia that sefer from the sefer ha'azara. So it's a very special sefer. And im lo hinichu lo avotav, o shene'evad, if he did not inherit a sefer, listen to this, if he did not inherit a sefer, or even if he had, but he had lost it, then he's got to write two Sifrei Torah, because now he doesn't have the sefer that he would have had before he became a melech. Of course, the problem is that that wouldn't have helped him anyway, because the Rambam said before that if he had a sefer as a hedyot, no hedyot is yotze with a sefer that he nichol avotav. Nobody. And here the Rambam is saying, if something happened to the Sefer Sheinichu Lo Avotav, then he has to write Shnei Sifrei Torah. Echad minichu bebeit kenazav, one of them he puts into his treasure house, because hu mitzuveh bo kekol echad miYisrael, he's no different than anybody else. Everyone has to have a Sefer Torah. Vasheni, the special Sefer of the Melech, lo yazuz milufanav, has to be in front of him at all times. The only time is when he's not allowed to. Beit Shikreis lebet hakise lebet hamerchatz. But otherwise, yotzei lamilchama v'huimo, nichnas v'huimo, yoshev bedin v'huimo, misa v'kenegdo, shenemar v'aitaimo v'karabo koyemei chayav. Right? So the Kesef Mishnah asks the obvious kasha. He says, v'yeshli t'moa al rabbeinu. Doesn't make sense what the Rambam is writing. Because it's pretty clear, Shinir Emi Dvarav, pretty clear that he's saying, She'imi niyach lo aviv Sefer Torah, that if in fact he did have a Sefer Torah which he inherited, eno chayav lichtov ela Sefer Torah echad, then he only has to write one Sefer. But that's a contradiction. V'ha'af ha'ed yot eno samech ha Sefer Torah she'niyach lo avotav. Because nobody is yotzei the mitzvah, even as a het yot, not a melech, unless he writes his own sefer. So what's the difference whether or not he had inherited a sefer? Makes no sense. So the Kesef Mishnah says, look, this is a very difficult problem. Yesh litchok, we can really push. Doesn't seem to make much sense, but we could say, yesh litchok velomar, Shrabbeinu Mefarish Tichish Shani Lo Tzrich L'Shtei Torot. What the Gemara says that the Melech has to write two Sifrei Torah, what it really means is Hachi Kama, that when it says by the Melech Shalo Yitgaeh B'Shel Achirim, which is Mashma Dover says Minyuchad B'Melech, really is only B'Sefer Torah Shechayav HaMelech Lichtov No Sofra Le'Hedyot. However, the Sefer Torah that he, the Melech, was Chayav B'Din HaHedyot, he specifically, because he's a Melech, can rely on the inherited Sefer. Why? Because a person who is not a Melech, who relies on an inherited Sefer, says the Kesef Mishnah, will never write a Sefer. But a Melech, even if he relies on the single Sefer that he inherited as a Hedyot, at least he will be Mekayim, a mitzvah of Ktivah Sefer Torah, as a Melech. And that's enough. V'sage b'hachi. Now, obviously, that's a very, very schleppy kind of svara. Where does he get that from? Where would the Rambam know such a thing from? And Lamaisa, I mean, the Mefarshim say, look, the Rambam must have had a hidden source. Maybe there's some brisa somewhere that we don't know about. I mean, why in the world would somebody say such a thing? Seems very mysterious, really. So let me suggest, first of all, an easier way of seeing it. Because there's, I think, a very simple way. And the simple way is based on the Rambam's own words in which he introduces the mitzvahs of Ksiva Sefer Torah at the beginning of Hilchas Sefer Torah. And you know the Rambam, before every halachot, lists, makes a list of the mitzvot in those halachot. So he's talking about Lios Tfilin al Arosh, and so on and so forth. Fourth mitzvah in Hilchas Tfilin Mezuzah Sefer Torah. Lichtov kol ish sefer Torah la'atzmo. Mitzvah 5. Lichtov ha-melech sefer sheni la'atzmo. Kedei shiyulo shnei sefer Torah. Now that is obviously saying something very simple. A melech needs to write a second sefer Torah. He does not need to be mekayim the mitzvah of ksiva sefer Torah twice. It's as simple as that. Why does he need to write a second Sefer Torah? The first Sefer Torah could have inherited. He just needs to have a Sefer Torah. The reason that the Melech is mitzuvah to write a Sefer Sheni Kedei Shiyalo Shnei Sefer Torah is very simple. This Sefer Torah has to be the Sefer Lishmo, and this is a lashon that the Rambam brings later, Lishmo shel HaMelech. It cannot be written like a normal Sefer Torah. It has to be written for the specific purposes of a king. The problem is that a king has no personal needs, because les lemi garme klum, that which defines Malchus, as we know, is that it's beyond any personal issue. If he needs this Sefer as his first Sefer, it's not the Sefer of a Melech. If he writes it as the Sefer of a Melech, then he's Yotzei, the specific Chiyuv of the Sefer of the Melech. If he has a Sefer, then he doesn't need a Sefer. He needs to write a Sefer. So fine, if you write the Sefer of a Melech, you're certainly including in that the mitzvah of writing a Sefer Torah. But the mitzvah of the Melech writing a second Sefer Torah is exactly what it's mashma with the very words that are mitzvah. Because the posik says, Vayaki shifto akisei mamlachto vekatavlo et mishneh haTorah hazot. So as Rashi explains, mishneh haTorah means shtei Sefer Torahs, the second Sefer. Mishneh is the second one, the double, the copy. Where he got the first one from is irrelevant. And this is the Rambam's Makor, as the Gemara brings it. And so, what this teaches us is an amazing thing. Because the point is that apparently there is a specific relationship of the Sefer to the individual and to the context of its writing, which is surprising, because one would think that a safer is a safer is a safer. And that's not true. This is more deeply brought out because of the din that that safer is possible if it isn't written lishmo, shel hamelech. Lishmo, not lishmo of the person as an individual, which normally would have been what's meant. If you write a document lishma, it's to the person. But here the Rambam's lashon is, the melech writes a sefer lishmo shel hamelech. Obviously speaking in third person, means that his relationship to it is a relationship in third person, to himself as third person. Lishmo shel hamelech. However, remarkably, the Rambam uses two lishonot that speak about the personal aspect of the purpose of the ksiva. One is Sefer Torah le'atzmo. The second word, he continues, le'atzmo l'shem hamelech. Now the issue is that every Sefer Torah, to every person, he uses exactly the same lashon, not the lishmo, of course, because there is no lishmo. But the halacha is specifically kotev le'atzmo Sefer Torah. And that le'atzmo Sefer Torah has a very, very beautiful meaning, because we know le'atzmo means something specially one's own. Kana shem tov, kana le'atzmo. It may even be the basis of an amazing halacha, which is, this is the way the Rama paskins, based on the Gemara Menachas, Om Reb Yeshua Barav, Om Reb Gidol Amarav, Halokeach Sefer Torah Men Hashuk, Kechotef Mitzvah Men Hashuk. I said, what does that mean? Kechotef Mitzvah Men Hashuk? I mean, and you buy your lulav and your esrog, that's called Kechotef Mitzvah Men Hashuk. Whatever that means. Katvo, if he writes it, Ma'alea Katuva Lav Kilu Kiblo Mi Har Sinai. And that's where Rav Shesha says, Im higia bo afilo otechat, fine, ma'ale lav kilu kotfo. The Rama paskins that the meaning of kichotev mitzvah min hashuk is that you're not yotze. That's how he paskins la locha. And that's how we paskin if we go according to the Rama in the Shulchan Aruch. Rashi says kichotev means it's not nice, but it's not chosser in the kiyum of the mitzvah. If the idea is li'atzmo, that li'atzmo means that part of the nature of the relationship to the Sefer Torah is that unique intimacy, then chotef mitzvah menashuk is like saying that if you want to make something special, a beautiful meal, you don't go to McDonald's. And if you do, then it was chotef, a meal from somewhere that has nothing to do with you. It's just generic. And therefore, it's chosser in the liatzmo. Amazing. There's another halacha, which is nogea, and that is how we paskin. Don't give your Sefer Torah to the Beit HaKnesset for everybody to learn from. Don't give it away, because then it won't be liatzmecha. It won't be yotze. You can lend it. So this actually changes the entire nature of the idea of the Sefer. It's the ktiva. It's the way in which it is written. It's the kavonas. And it's a certain intimacy which we need to explore. What would that mean? But it's clearly the relationship of the Sefer. La'atzmo, la'melech, is personal. Personal, not in the normal human sense of personal, the sentimental, the intimately involved in the human, but personal in the sense of one's existential self, le'atzmo, the etzem sense, the innate centerpiece of one's life, atzmo. Turns out that the 22 years are truly keneged haktav. Rabbi Yochanan wasn't just taking a silly remez, well, it must be 22 is connected the otiot to the olive base. That's not the point. If it's the Ktav that created that relationship, then that's what he was zeicha to. And indeed, Ksiva is amazing because Ksiva defines Moshe himself, right? Moshe, on the last day of his life, writes 13 Sifrei Torah. The Rambam brings Biksav Yado. It had to be done in his own handwriting. Took those Sforim, gave one to each Shevet, and all Biksav Yado. And this is called the greatest moment of Moshe Rabbeinu's life. How do we know that? Because the Gemara in Sota speaks of what happened on the day that Moshe Rabbeinu was Nifter, and what things, what statements were made in the Shamayim. And the last thing is, Tanya Rebbe Eliezer HaGadol Omer, it was Shneimasar Mil al Shneimasar Mil, Keneged Machane Yisrael. There was a bas kol that came out from the Shamayim and repeated, Vayomos Moshe Safra Rabba di Yisrael. An amazing thing to call Moshe Rabbeinu the great sofer of Yisrael. And that, says the Maharal, this is Dover Zehu HaMadrega HaAchrona Shel Moshe. This was the last and highest Madrega that Moshe Rabbeinu reached. This is after teaching Kol HaTorah Kula for all of those 40 years. The last Madrega was Safra Rabba, the Ksiva V'Sefer Torah, Biksav Yodai. Oh, it's absolutely amazing. The same exact things happens with the godless of Ezra Sefer. Hu Ezra Alam Mibavel, V'hu Sofer Mahir B'Torat Moshe. Therefore, says the Gemara, that pasuk teaches us that Ezra Sefer could have given the Torah Ilmale Moshe Shekadmo. Problem is, Moshe came first. But clearly he had that darga. Tanya Rabbi Yossi Eimer. Ro'ui haya Ezra shetinaten Torah yado Ilmale kodmo Moshe. How do we see that? Same lotion in the pasuk. Moshe Allah el Elohim. Be'ezra omer Ezra la mi bavel. Ma aliyah mur kantora. Af aliyah mur la lantora. And by Moshe it says, Oti tziva Hashem ba'it ha'il lelamed etchem chukim u'mishpatim. What does it say by Ezra? Ezra hechin levavo lidrot et Hashem, lidrosh et Hashem, lasot v'lelamed Yisrael chuk u'mishpat. And then the Gemara says the most astonishing thing. A crazy thing. The afalpi shalom nitna Torah yado, it's true that there was a logistical problem of his being the one to give the Torah, and that was the simple fact that Moshe was older than he was. So Moshe came first. So he got there first. Okay. But nonetheless, basically he did the same thing. Why? Because haktav nishtana al yado. The tzurat haktav, the ktav ashurit, which is merumas in the same words of the din of the ksiva of the Sefer Torah, et mishneh haTorah hazot. Mishneh haTorah, says the Gemara, means ktav haraui lehishtanot. So it's mishneh, mishtaneh. So therefore, essentially, he did the same thing. You know, Moshe brought the Torah down. Ezra changed the ktav. So even though he didn't get to give the Torah itself, as if the tzura of the otiyot of the ktiva is the equivalent of the safra rabba, the yisrael, and the actual taking the Sefer Torah from HaKadosh Baruch Hu and being yizoych. And this is why Talmidei Chachamim, I need it anyways, what can I do? Take a chance. Talmidei Chachamim are called sofrim. Why are they called sofrim? Lama nikru sofrim. Shall you sofrim kol otiyot shebat Torah? They would count, literally count, all of the yosyos. And that's why we have in the Mesera, Vov de Gachon, is Chetzon shel yosyos shel Sefer Torah, Dorosh Dorash, Chetzon shel Tevot, Ve'it Galach, Yechar Semen HaChazir Miyar, Ayin of Yar, is Chetzon shel Tehil, and so on and so forth. So that means the entire chashivas of Talmidei Chachamim, Divrei Seferim, that idea comes because of their chavivus of the ksav of the Torah, that they would actually count the osiyos in the Sefer Torah. Absolutely amazing. And that means that the way, the remez that we know, that Yisrael, as we're told, Mishom Roya Even Yisrael, that Yisrael is Gematria, it's an otrikon. Yesh Shishim Ribu Otiot La Torah is Yisrael. So that there's a sheresh of the neshama of each of the Dor HaMidbar as the mocker of Yisrael for the generations in one tzura of an os in the Sefer Torah. And the fact is, of course, that the perfection, the amazing perfection of the Ksav is the essence of the Sefer. Otherwise, it's barely usable. Listen to this halacha. I mean, it's a little bit crazy. You have a beautiful Koran, Chamisha Chumshei Torah, with even the Tzurah of the Daf from the Sefer Torah. Perfectly muge, not one mistake. Everything, every chaser, every yeter, every tzura saparsha, every tzura shira, absolutely perfect. Exactly the same content. Printed, written, but written without kavana, l'shem, this mitzvah, or with the wrong kavana. Not only is it not a machmad einecha, not only does it not have any relationship to you, but as the Rambam says, that if any one of the 20 issues which can puzzle the ksav of the Sefer Torah takes place, im nase bo echad mehen, areyu kechumash min achumashim, that can be used for school children's books, shem lamdim bahem tinokot, ve'en bo kedushat Sefer Torah, forget about the kedusha. You're allowed to become, after all, kids can't be expected to lug around a Sefer Torah to school, so we allow them to carry these chumashim. But don't use it for anything else. I mean, certainly, ein korinbo barabim or anything like that. I mean, it's, you know what type of mistakes we're talking about in the Ktav, you know? I mean, mistakes that you need a magnifying glass to pick up on, you know? Mistakes where a little tiny piece of ink of one oat touches another. Mistakes in which the normal size of the letter is missing a little bit of ink, which we filled in today. An extra letter here and there that makes absolutely no difference. You spell something with a vav, you spell something without a vav, it's read exactly the same way. Slightly too much distance between two letters that might make it look like it's in two separate words rather than the standard. And then there's things that even a magnifying glass is not going to help you one bit. And that is, you wrote the Shem Hashem without the proper kavana, you know? Or someone who is an apikoros wrote the Sefer Torah, didn't have the right attitude. It's a chumash. Anything that is different, it's a chumash. So the perfection of the ksav, people think Torah should be ksav, means the written Torah. That's not what it means. As the Zohar points out, if that's what it meant, it would have said, exactly as it says, Torah Shebal Peh, it would have said, Torah Shebal Ktav. Why does it say, Torah Shebichtav, says the Zohar? It doesn't say, Lo Yikrei Al HaKtav, Ela Shebichtav, Dekaima Bichtav. It exists only inside those letters. Those letters become a heichal that contain the Sefer Torah within them. It exists within that heichal. And there it is shaped, there it is cared for. That's why Ikri Torah Shebichtav velo al haktav. We're talking about an entirely different vision than the way we normally understand the meaning of a Sefer Torah. And then the beautiful Gemara in Masechet Shabbat, in which Rabbi Yochanan explains, what does the word Anochi Hashem Elokecha, what does Anochi mean? Why doesn't it just say Ani? Anochi had to be said because Anochi stands for the words Ana Nafshi Ketiva Yahivat. I, with my soul, that's the real meaning of Atzmi, is Nafshi. In Aramaic, Le'atzmo is Le'nafshoi. Ana Nafshi Ketiva. It's I, myself, gave this written Torah. And that means that the entire pnimius of the nefesh, ha-nefesh ha-netuna b'toch ha-ktav, as the Noam Elimelech says, many, many sforim talk about that idea. That's the beautiful pshat that you can, very interesting, the Likutei Halachos. I love the strange things that the Likutei Halachos brings. But he brings such a fascinating thing, that graphology is based on that. Because he says, look, it's Ayidei Haktav Yecholim Lahakir HaNefesh Upnimius Shoresh HaNefesh. You can recognize the way things come out in Ktiva, the most intimate insights into the actual soul of the person. So let's look at the centrality of Ktiva. Just, we have the fact that if you write it, it's Ke'ilu Kiblo Misinai. It's the fact that the word Mishneh Torah can either mean a Sefer Shel HaMelech, or it can mean Ktav, that is Mishtaneh, which means that it's a juxtaposition to the Etzem Torah itself. The fact that Moshe had to write all these for him in his own hands. The fact that giving over a Sefer Torah in his hands to each of the Shevet was Mechayev that Shevet, specifically because of that. Lederes, the Madrega of Safra Rabba. The fact that HaKadosh Baruch Hu speaks about Anochi in this sense, the Ana Nafshoi, that this is the Sherish of the Pnimiyes of the Torah. Now this is the most amazing difference between the way the Greeks looked at writing and the way that Klal Yisrael speaks of this Ksiva. I want to tell you something. People think that writing was always a given to civilization, and it wasn't. And it took a very long time for modern people to accept, and it took a lot of scholarship to prove that the great Greek so-called books were never books. They were all oral. It was all Torah Shebaal Peh. And basically, what Plato has Socrates saying is a beautiful insight. And he says like this, this invention, writing, this invention is not going to be good. It will produce forgetfulness in the minds of those who learn to use it. Because they won't use their memory. They're going to trust in their iPad. Oh, no, they trust in writing. And here's the key, beautiful way of expressing it. They trust in writing produced by external characters which are no part of themselves. Beautiful, right? That will discourage the use of their own memory within them. You have invented an elixir, not of memory, but of reminding. You hear the insights, the difference? This is not memory. This is reminding. Big deal. Memory is something internal. Reminding is a little notice that your secretary sends you, or a little note that pops up on your cell phone. You offer your Talmidim the appearance of wisdom, not true wisdom. Oh yeah, they'll read many things without a Rebbe, without instruction, and therefore they will seem to know many things when they are ignorant and they're hard to get along with. You understand the interrelationship? Since they are not wise, they only appear to be wise. Amazing, right? So it's totally external, and that's the problem. Whereas to us, as we just saw, it has the potential to be the expression of the nefesh itself in the deepest way. I mean, look at the difference between a chumash and a sefer Torah. The difference between just the information and a living presence. You want to hear the way the Rambam beautifully describes this living presence in two separate halachas, which are very different. We need to see why they're different. Mitzvah le'yached le'sefer Torah makom. First of all, you need to provide a place, an orein, for a sefer Torah. U'lechabdo u'lehadro yoter midai. Beyond anything normal, to be mechabedet, to make it beautiful, like our sefer Torah. Why is this? Dvarim shebeluchot habrit, hein besefer. What? Every chumash has the luchot habrit written in it. That's not the point. The ananafshoi k'tiva yehiva. Only that appears in the sefer that was written in that ksav. It doesn't appear in the chumash. The reminder appears, yes, but not the thing. But the sefer has those luchos habris. Were those luchos habris put inside of an orein? Then that sefer has to be put inside of an orein. It is the luchos habris. That's first halacha. Then comes a completely different halacha. Amazing. A sefer Torah, kol mi sheyoshev lifnei sefer Torah, yoshev bekoved rosh, be'ema v'fachad. You sit in front of a sefer Torah in trepidation and trembling. Why? Not because it's the luchot habrit. Shehu ha'ed ha'ne'eman l'chol ba'ei olam. This is the ultimate witness. Witness. You must remember, witness does not mean reminder, does not mean a video of Maimed Har Sinai, a video of Maisa Bereshis, the echoes of the Big Bang. That's not what an aid is. An aid is a living presence. Knowing something doesn't give you aidus. A Bezdin that knows something from their own vision, they witness the murder. They cannot paskin based on what they saw the next day and get up and be Mechayev the murderer. They need to have witnesses because the witness is the living event. The Torah is the aid, l'chol bei olam, shenemar v'hayasham becha la'ed. That Sefer Torah has to be yours as the ultimate witness. So in exactly the same way, the Gemara makes an amazing interrelationship with the Pasuk, Vavei Ha'amudim. Vavei Ha'amudim, Bepashtis means the little hooks that were on the things that held up the curtains in the Mishkan, says the Gemara. The Amudim, we know, U'la'ad Olamei Olamim, they never changed. Ma Ha'amudim Lo Yishtanu Af Ha'vavim. The vavim in the ktav never changed. So that's the man the Amar argues on Mishnah Torah, on the changing of the Torah. Okay? That puts the Sefer Torah on the level of the Mishkan as a recreation of Maimed Har Sinai. But there is one essential condition to this Eidus. And that essential condition to make it the ultimate presence is above and beyond the Dvorim that are in the Luchais that the Rambam mentioned in the first halacha. And in order to see this, we need to read the Parshas Vayelech and to see how the Dinim of Ksiva Sefer, it's only another 3 hours, how long is the tape? To see the difference in the way the Torah presents the entire halacha of the Sefer Torah. So listen to this. Moshe Rabbeinu is telling us in Vayelech, Hashem olech lefanecha, hu yiyemcha, lo yarpecha, velo yazveka, lo tira, velo techat. This is all Moshe Rabbeinu's tzivoy to Yehoshua. And what he tells Yehoshua is, Vayikra Moshe le Yehoshua, Vayomer elav le'enei ko Yisrael, chazak v'amatz. Famous words that we keep reading in Yehoshua. Chazak v'amatz, And then he says something a little nasty. Ki ata tavol et ha'am hazeh al ha'aretz asher nishba Adonai la'avotam latet lahem v'ata tanchileinu otam. You will come with this nation. Not you will bring this nation. You will come with this nation. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu didn't like this. And we find that HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, instead, ata tavi, you have to bring them. As Rashi says, take a stick of wood and hit them on the head. Achal kat kadam. What do you mean, this is a democracy? You lead them into Eretz Yisrael. Okay. So this is the first parsha of the Tzivui LeYoshua, in which he's told, ata tavo. Immediately it says, vayichtov Moshe at Torah hazot, vayitna el ha-kohanim b'nei Levi, ha-nosim et Aron Brit Adonai, v'olkol ziknei Yisrael. You'll notice that this is a bit strange because the Kohanim are not normally the ones that carry the Orah. The Levim are the ones that carry the Orah. There are special, unbelievable moments of history, three times in history, that Kohanim carry the Orah. Fine. And so, vayitzav Moshe otam lemor, Miket Sheva Shanim, Shnas Hashmita, Hakel es b'nei Yisrael. No, it's the mitzvah of Hakel. The Melech should get up and Tikra to Torah Zot Neged Ko Yisrael Bozneim. Fine. This Sefer Torah is here identified with the Sefer that would be read in Hakel. The next parsha begins with HaKadosh Baruch Hu saying to Moshe, I want you to call Yehoshua and I'm going to tell him my message. So, Vayelech Moshe v'Yoshua v'yityatzvu ba'omoed. HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes in the Onan and he says, things are going to be awful after you die. In chashochei v'mavotecha v'kama amazeh v'zona achreelu, etc., etc., etc. V'anochi astir astir panai b'yomahu. Whole long list of awful events. And therefore, and here comes the mitzvah that we are Isaac in now. And now, kitvu lachem et hashira hazot v'lamdad b'nei Yisrael sima b'fiem l'man t'yeli hashira hazot l'ed b'nei Yisrael. So this second tzivui is the tzivui of the Torah as ha'ed ha'ne'eman that the Rambam brought. And so, when I kintim tzenot rabot tzarabot v'tzaraot rabot v'tzaraot, I want this edut. Anta shira hazot lefanav la'ein, ki lo tishachach mipizaro, etc. Immediately, vayichtov Moshe ta shira hazot b'yom ahu, vayalamdat b'nei Yisrael. And then it says, vayitzav et Yehoshua benun, vayomer chazak v'yamatz, ki ata tavi et b'nei Yisrael. El ha'aretz asher nishbati lahem, vanochi ehye imach. All of the Rishonim on the Chumash, without a single exception, say that the words Vayetzavet Yehoshua Binun are clearly a reference back to the opening pasuk, which said, Kra et Yehoshua v'tyatzvu bo'omo et va'atzavenu. So this is the Vayetzav, it doesn't, even though it sounds like it's Moshe being mitzave, this clearly is the v'atzavenu that HaKadosh Baruch Hu opened the proceedings with. Of course, the problem then is, why in the world does it say Vayechtov Moshe Tashira Hazot right in the middle of this Ma'amar? Do you think it's because, well, that's when he did it? He sat down and wrote it. No, because the very next pasuk says, immediately after that, Vayhi kechalot Moshe lichtov et divrei haTorah hazot al sefer atumam. This time he calls the Levim. Vayetzav Moshe et halevim, who now suddenly have become nosei aron brit Hashem limor, lakoach et sefer haTorah hazeh, v'samtem oto mitzad aron brit Adonai Eloichem, v'haya sham b'cha la'ed. That means that the second parasha is the parasha of the Edut. The first parasha is the parasha in which we read Sefer HaTorah Hazot, which really only means Mishnah Torah, says the Gemara. And that is not the Edut. That is what is read in order to remember the Inyanim. So, we have to ask ourselves, I mean, if Edut, obviously the first Chelek, which was referring to the Sefer of the Melech, as the Ramban writes, as Rashi writes, Rabbeinu Bachya writes, everyone explains, even though it doesn't say that Moshe wrote it Atumo. It wouldn't have been a kosher Sefer if he hadn't written it Atumo. So obviously later on after the Shira, what it's referring to here is a full Sefer Torah that he gave originally to the Kohanim. Okay, so it's all sort of a compressed outside of time single event that we're meant to see, in which parts are written earlier, parts are written later, because otherwise it wouldn't be a kosher Sefer. But what that means is that original halacha, the reason it doesn't mention Ad Tumo there, and it comes before Ad Tumo, is because it's only a logistic problem of needing a Sefer kosher. But it's not the din that is mechayev the Edus. And therefore, we wait to hear until the end what makes the Edus Gechalot Moshe Ad Tumo. It's the conclusion, the holism. It's that singularity. It's the Kisvul Achemet Hashira Hazot. Note the implications of that. It doesn't say to write the Torah. It says to write this song. And the reason that it has to be a song is because that which the Ktiva V'Sefer Torah creates is what poetry creates, not what prose creates. It has to recreate the picture of Hadvarim Asher Ro'u Einecha. Hadvarim Asher Ro'u Einecha, when you see something, you don't see a thing that you process in a linear fashion. A picture is worth a thousand words. So how do you recreate that picture? No matter how many words you use, you'll never put that picture together again. There's only one use of language that can do that, and that is poetry. Shira, where the interrelationship of words is outside of any linear context, in which a word that occurs later redefines what was there earlier. A symphony of words, a picture of words. The ksiva that creates Edus is a holistic ksiva that is of a totally different quality. It's a singularity. The interrelationship of every last os, every last tag, every last remez that contains the universe, the kli chemda, sheba nivra olam. That's what stands in the power of Edus. That yichud of the Shechina, that yichud of my separations, that yichud of my Har Sinai, that lives as a single entity. So then we have to ask ourselves, and what about the fact that both stories revolve around handing the future over to Yoshua? What is the significance of the first Sefer discussed here is Atat Tavo Et Ha'am. And the second Sefer discussed here is Atat Tavi Et Ha'am. And both of them are smack bang as if, I mean, a total non sequitur. When in the middle of talking about the Tzivu to Yoshua, all of a sudden we do the Tzivu the Sefer Torah, then back to Yoshua again. I mean, what in the world is Yoshua involved in? So, I think that the Rambam himself has figured out, and is the only one that points it out, has figured out the entire meaning of this thing. And this is what it means. Here's how the Rambam introduces the entire Mishneh Torah. Sounds familiar, those words? So his Mishneh Torah is there to give us a vision of that totality. And here's how he introduces it. Kol HaTorah Katva Moshe Rabbeinu Kodem Sheyamut Bichtav Yado, V'natan Sefer L'chol Shevet V'Shevet, V'Sefer Echad Natnu Ba'aron La'ed, Shenemar L'koach Et Sefer HaTorah Hazeh, V'Samtem Oto, exactly the psukim that we just read. Now, Afal Pi, Shalom Nichtava Torah Shebal Peh, It's true that the Torah Shebaal Peh is not written by definition, but he taught that Torah Shebaal Peh, and LeYehoshua, Shu Talmido Shel Moshe Rabbeinu, Masar Torah Shebaal Peh, Vitzivahu Alav, to his, what do you mean, Yehoshua, who was Talmido Shel Moshe? Everybody is Talmido Shel Moshe. Moshe Rabbeinu, Rabban Shel Kol Anavim, Rabban Shel Kol Yisrael. What is he talking about, Bichlal? Vili Yehoshua, Shu Talmido Shel Moshe. What? The Shivim Zakenim were not. Elazar Pinchas was not. They were all Makabo from Moshe Rabbeinu. But there's only one Talmido Shel Moshe, says the Rambam. And that is based on the fact that he was Mitzaveh Yehoshua. Where the heck does it say he was Mitzaveh Yehoshua? And so, the Rambam is clearly understanding exactly the way that the Malbim understood, the Malbim obviously is taking it off of the Rambam, that is, as soon as HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Moshe Rabbeinu, you are not going to cross the Yarden, V'tzavet Yehoshua v'chazkeyu v'amtzeyu. Sound familiar? Chazak v'amatz. Tzavet Yehoshua asks the Malbim, but this happened a long time ago. This happened when Moshe Rabbeinu asks HaKadosh Baruch Hu, find an ish asher ruach boy. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, yes, kach lechot Yehoshua benun, ish asher ruach bo, and set him up, and Moshe Rabbeinu does. And there it says, here's Mitzavet Yehoshua. Why does he told again in Vetchanan, Mitzavet Yehoshua? Says the Malbim, Al pizet zivalo shenit, sheyitzaveh Yehoshua. What is that shenit? Kolel bezeh sheyitzaveh oto Torah Shebaal Peh. Kamo shekatuv, Moshe kibel Torah misinai, umisara leYehoshua. This was that tzivoy. Now obviously the Rambam is learning that. So in other words, the Rambam understands that the interruption between the first part of the parsha, Kraz Yehoshua va'atzaveyu, then all of a sudden va'yichtov Moshe et hashira hazot, and then back to va'yitzav et Yehoshua, means that that tzivui at the end was the expression of the tzivui of the change that HaKadosh Baruch Hu insisted on, which is atatavi, and which included the original tzav, which is the tzav of responsibility for Torah Shebaal Peh, which required, for some strange reason, the special relationship of Yehoshua. And this, says the Shach, that when it says, V'tzavas Yehoshua, immediately after, Ravlach, you are not going to make it, Moshe, V'tzavet Yehoshua, which sounds harsh and which sounds painful, actually, says the Shach, is pious. Paiso HaKadosh Baruch Hu lomar, shekol zman shel talmido kayam, ki'ilu hu kayam. Don't feel bad that Yehoshua will be taking your place. Tzavet Yehoshua. Make Yehoshua the one who will be indeed l'talmido shel Moshe tziva. So now, how are we meant to understand this? There's a simple hint in the Torah proper how to understand it. Kisvu lachem et hashira hazot sima b'fihem. Did you ever hear such a contradiction in your life? Kisvu lachem means it needs to be a Torah shebichtav with all of the dinim of ktav. Sima b'fihem means, says the Gemara, well, when you're learning Mishnayos, make simanim, because it says sima b'fihem. Simanim b'fihem. Now, how does Torah shebichtav get into your mouth? What do you mean, sima b'fiyam? Obviously, that sima b'fiyam, that is ki al piya Torah, is it Torah shebiksav, or is it Torah shebaal peh? That is the problem. And to understand the solution, we need to look once again to Amavdil ben Kedesh Lechol, and let us listen to what Socrates has to say about the problems of a Torah shebiksav. What Socrates has to say about a Torah which is meant to recreate a picture. Hadvarim asher ra'u einecha. Because this is what Plato says that Socrates says. Writing has this strange quality, and it's very much like painting. You know, but the creatures of a painting, they stand there as if they're living beings, but if one asks them a question, they preserve a solemn silence. And so it is with written words. You might think they spoke as if they had intelligence, but if you question them, wishing to know about their sayings, they always say only one and the same thing. Now, this is a serious problem, isn't it? Because after all, for a Sefer Torah to be Edus, one of the most essential aspects of Edut is mipihem velo mipi kitavam. You cannot have Edut that is written. So how in the world can a written Sefer Torah be Edut anyway? And here we reach the real meaning of the relationship that creates the concept of Torah as Edus. And I will close with this, because this, I think, is the important nekuda. The idea, essentially, is similar to the idea of how we refer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. El Chai V'Kayam. Chai V'Kayam is a contradiction. Something that is Kayam, something that is absolute, something that is whole, is something that is unchanging by definition. It's like the words that Socrates complains of. Keep saying the same thing again and again. Because in the deepest sense, it is complete in what it is. It is every possible interrelationship and every possible event all wrapped up in one singularity, like the universe is before it expands. That is Kayam. Chai is exactly the opposite. Life, living, is by definition dynamic. The whole point of identifying living as opposed to Kayam is the fact that it's in constant dynamic motion and change, movement, development, chiddush. No one instant is ever like any other instant. So how can you have both Chai v'Kayam in exactly the way that you have Kitvu lachem et hashira hazot sima b'fiyem? The relationship of the Ktav that we're talking about over here, of the Ad Tumo, the Moshe's Ktiva, that relationship is as the relationship of Moshe's active mind to sharing with Yoshua in its entirety of its activity. That idea is that the Torah Shebaal Peh makes the Torah Shebichtav speak to us. It does not stand there when you ask a question and not give you answers, any more than the universe itself does. The universe is whole. It gives you answers. You ask the right questions. You set up the right experiments. You create precisely the situation and say, now what? And you get answers, unbelievable answers. That's what the Torah does with the Torah Shebaal Peh. But the interrelationship of the Shlemus that was given over by that ksav of singularity of Moshe, who was capable of containing within himself every last aspect of it, to be able to share his mind as if he had never died, that is not Talmud in the sense of someone who has been taught. That is Talmud, who is the one that continues to develop and change and to do all the things that life means as if it's your own active mind that is interrogating and being machadish within the Torah itself. It's only the relationship of those two things that create the edut. Otherwise, the Torah is locked in its heichal and has nothing to say to us. It's a big mistake to think Torah shebichtav, Torah shebal peh, those are the two, you know, the written Torah, the oral Torah, two aspects of, you know, the things that we know from the book and then the things that were given over to the rabbis. It's absolute ridiculous. The idea of the interrelationship of Torah shebichtav and Torah shebal peh is the creation of one living entity, one without the other, is inconceivable. Not because of informational problems, but because of the existential issue of what constitutes presence, what constitutes edut, what constitutes Torat Chaim. Only these two things of the Sima Bifiyam, Vehayubach Lechem La'ed, Vahu Ha'ed Ha'ne'eman. And that is the idea, just like this Ma'amad, utterly beyond the human personal, but touching on the truly personal, Nitzchias, not the Shecheyonu v'kiyamonu v'igiyonu lazman hazeh, but the Kiyum, the Nitzchias of that moment. And it turns all of those interrelationships of the Torah that we have learned over all those years, or whatever moments they were together, into things that are netzach, forever beyond issues of personal jealousies, personal resentments, personal failings. They have no connection to the personal, no connection to the Shechiyonu. It's a sharing of atzmi. It's a sharing of atzmiut. It's our sharing together the sima b'fiyam of the moment of standing be'ima b'fachad in front of the Eid HaNe'eman, which contains us all, which makes each of those moments of the times and the Torah that we have shared a netzach beyond all sentimentality and all of the smallness of what we call personal within the limitations of Olam Hazeh. And that's why I say your presence is an innate part of the mitzvah in this case, and therefore is just as much a chelek of the mitzvah's lav le'enes nitnu, and makes it so much, therefore, a ma'amad that goes beyond any person and any personal, and gives a standing to the Torah that we have shared and Bezras Hashem will continue to share, which may we be zocha to share always new chidushim, new active mind, all within the context of that amazing presence of the Eima V'Fachad, of this wonderful Sefer that I thank you for once again with all my heart. And I can only tell you that the experience, my own experience of the years of Zikna. And the Mishnah defines the years of Zikna. Those are the years from 60 to 70. Those are years of Zikna. My own experience of the years of Zikna was very similar to Carl Jung's definition of that period. A period of worrying about mortality, of trying to integrate life, of worrying about things left undone and what has to be done for the future. The period of Seiva is a totally different period. It's the opposite of Zikna. One would think, what's the difference between Zikna and Seiva? A couple of extra white hairs. But it sounds silly, you know. This is Zikna, this is Seiva. It's an entirely different phase of life, which is exactly this ma'amad. Because what it is, and I can show it to you from the Gemara, very simple. Rabbi Yochanan used to stand up for Baalei Seiva, whether they were Jewish or non-Jewish, made no difference to him. And if it was a man of Seiva, a man over 70, he would stand up and he would say, ah, kamar patkai adu aleahu gavra. Imagine the adventures that have passed over this human being. What's the difference if he's Jewish, not Jewish? This is an amazing creation, a life. A life walks in front of me and I don't stand up for it. A unique, amazing state of the universe and I don't stand up for me. And what do you think? That at 69 there weren't all of these amazing experiences? And at 65 there wasn't? And what about at 50? Is that enough experiences, amazing experiences? The Adu Aleihu Gavra? I'll tell you the very simple. You don't stand up for a life where the individual himself does not have the perspective of his own life because then he doesn't live it. Then it's just disassociated. Hapatkai Adu Aleihu Gavra. I don't stand up for every novel, for God's sake. But this stage of perspective, which is connected the idea of the entirety of possible interrelationships now being open to the interactiveness of mind, the sharing, the most intense love that's involved in the sharing of the thinking and the seeing and the knowing and the experiencing of those divrei Torah. That is something that is unique and particularly meaningful in terms of that special perspective. And so I give you all my very profound experiential, existential, and personal nitzrias thanks and hopes for sharing much of that nitzrias together, both in Olam Hazeh and Liosid Lavai, Li'olam. Thank you very much, all of you, and especially those nichnasim la'ovi hakorah.
I'm gonna... Good. Good.